Esteemed judges, the faculty on stage, and my dear colleagues. So I undertook my thesis in the fast-paced research field of refractive surgery, and I got my first postgraduate thesis on SMILE. Small incision lenticular extraction was first described by Walter Secondo in 2010, and it is a flapless non-ablative keratorefractive procedure, an alternative to femtosecond LASIK, which needs no introduction. So SMILE was being increasingly used worldwide, but the paucity of literature from Indian studies and no cohort study was taken under till 2016 with a concurrent evaluation of ocular surface, corneal biomechanics, and ultrastructure. So primary objective would be to compare the refractive outcomes, and secondary would be biomechanical, anatomical, and dry eye parameters. It was a prospective non-randomized study with subjects recruited during the period January to December 2017. 40 eyes of 20 patients were there in each group after due ethical clearance and written informed consent. We included only patients with moderate to high myopia, that is 3 to 10 diopters, astigmatism less than 3 diopters, and minimum calculated residual stromal bed thickness of 300 microns. All the other contraindications to refractive surgery being there, we also excluded patients with previous surgery or retreatment. A comprehensive ocular examination was undertaken, and dry evaluation was done with tear breakup time, Schirmer's test, tear osmolarity strips. Abrometry was done using ray tracing abrometry, total hyoid aberrations, coma trefoil, spherical aberration. Corneal biomechanics were undertaken in the ocular response analyzer and confocal microscopy using the HRT3 with RCM. The baseline parameters showed that there was no statistically significant difference between the two groups. Appropriate statistical analysis was undertaken. All values were reported as mean plus minus standard deviation. There is a lot of data to present, but I'll try to be concise. In the post-op period, we see that the uncorrected distance visual acuity was similar in both the groups at all follow-up periods. No statistically significant difference was seen. As compared to the spherical equivalent, we also see that there was no statistically significant difference at any of the follow-up period. Coming on to the dry eye parameters, the tear breakup time, we only see that the LASIK group had a worse tear breakup time at the 6-month period, which was statistically significant. Regarding the Schirmer's test, we see that SMILE patients had a relatively better value of Schirmer's test at each of the follow-up period. So we undertook confocal microscopy, and from those images, using the standard procedure of image J using a Neuron J plugin, we found out the subbasal nerve fiber density. So here we see that in the LASIK group, there was a worse value of subbasal nerve fiber density at each of the follow-up period, and relative nerve preservation was seen in the SMILE group. To illustrate a case, here is one patient with SMILE. After post-operative 1 month, there is relative sparing of the nerves, and regeneration is seen at post-operative 6 months versus the femtosecond LASIK group. So seeing the corneal biomechanics, corneal histiasis, which gives us some idea of how the corneal biomechanics are, we find relatively better values in the SMILE group at each of the follow-up period. However, this was not so significant for the corneal resistance factor. In the aberrometry, the total higher order aberrations, only at the 6 month, we see relatively worse higher order aberrations in the LASIK group. Similarly, spherical aberrations were also worse in the LASIK group, only at the 6 month follow-up. And tear osmolarity, corneal resistance factor, trefoil and coma did not show any statistically significant difference. Comparison with the concurrent literature at that time, Ganesh et al. Had reported 3-month outcomes. In our case, none of the eyes lost any line of corrected distance visual acuity. No 6-month data were reported. And TBUT and Schirmer's test values were significantly higher than the LASIK group at each follow-up. Similar results were seen by Lee, M et al. And Kobashi et al. Corneal subbasal nerve fiber density was significantly better in our 1 and 6 month. However, this was not seen in a similar study undertaken by Lee et al. So corneal histiasis was better, but no significant difference in resistance factor. So total higher order aberration, spherical aberration was significantly higher in the LASIK group at the 6 month follow-up period. So other groups have also reported that spherical aberrations are lower in SMILE group. So this was the first study which comprehensively evaluated the anatomical, visual, biomechanical outcomes. The refractive outcomes showed similar efficacy, safety, and predictability. Schirmer's and TBUT values were better in SMILE. They had better subbasal nerve density. Total hyoid aberrations, spherical aberrations were better in the SMILE group. So corneal hysteresis was also found to be better in our group, but further research on corneal biomechanics is needed. We had only ORA, but maybe with other systems such as Corvus, So there is a potential advantage, but further research needs to be undertaken, and which is nowadays happening in the field of SMILE. Thank you.
Dr. Arjun Desai, please get ready. Panelists, please.
Dr. Brar,
yes.
You had shown some differences between the two groups, but will the differences actually resulted in some kind of a subjective difference? Was there any patient symptoms also given importance in this post-operative evaluation? Did it correlate? So you may have some findings.
Yes, sir.
In terms of objectively looking at the TBT values or the Schirmer's or the subnasal nerve density, but did it translate into some kind of a symptomatology difference?
So my thesis patients reported subjective improvements, but I could not objectively put it into a scoring system or find out whether they...
See, because these are only numbers. It may not clinically be any kind of difference in the patient's symptoms.
No, sir. All patients...
There will be always some difference in when you check the two techniques are slightly different.
Yes, sir.
So obviously, these physical parameters will obviously be, or diagnostic parameters will be different.
Yes, sir.
But what translates into, you know, clinical patient symptoms is what is probably given credence. So did you really check that? Because just checking the parameters, will it translate into patient symptoms?
So the patients who came after SMILE in their follow-ups, they reported lesser ocular irritation because they said that as compared to the femtosecond group.
Was
but
objective thing?
No, sir, that is what I'm saying. I did not, I wasn't able to put a...
So probably that is the flaw in the study where we
yes,
are not
sir,
really putting
limitation.
Any objective questionnaire for the patient symptoms.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Anand. Please come and collect your certificate from our chairperson.
Dr. Kuresh, sir, please give
away
the certificate.
Dr. Arjun, please get ready.
Good afternoon to one and all present here. I'm Dr. Arjun and I'll be presenting my thesis study on dry eye disease and ocular morbidity in individuals with sleep disorders. There has been a recent interest in dry eye disease and sleep pattern and sleep quality, and obstructive sleep apnea is known to be associated with various ocular morbidities. These can involve the eyelid as in floppy eyelid syndrome, ptosis, ectropion, involve the anterior segment as in dry eye disease, punctate epithelial keratopathy and keratoconus, involve the posterior segment involving the retina in central serous chorioretinopathy, vascular occlusions involving the optic nerve in papilledema, glaucoma and NAION. Obstructive sleep apnea is objectively defined when the apnea hypopnea index is greater than or equals to 5 on overnight polysomnography and is clinically suspected when a patient complains of non-refreshing sleep, excessive daytime sleepiness, frank apnea during sleep and excessive snoring. The intervention for obstructive sleep apnea is CPAP or continuous positive airway pressure therapy. We did a review of literature and we found studies. We studied the sleep pattern and sleep quality in dry eye disease patients, ocular morbidity and OSA, and studies which evaluated the effect of CPAP on dry eye disease. And we realized that there was a paucity of literature on the ocular surface and dry eye disease and MGD in particular in OSA patients. And most studies were done in patients with pre-existing and established OSA or ocular morbidities, and not in patients who were objectively diagnosed with a polysomnography and patients who were treatment naive for OSA. So we decided to fill the gap in medical literature and conduct a comprehensive ophthalmic evaluation in the Indian subgroup of OSA populations. And we designed a study where the primary aim was to assess the occurrence of dry eye disease in patients with sleep disorders, and the secondary aims were to determine other associated ocular diseases in patients with sleep disorders and to assess the effect of sleep therapy on ocular surface parameters in OSA patients. We included patients with suspected sleep disorders as screened by the pulmonologist, patients who are undergoing a sleep study, and patients who are above 18 years of age. We excluded patients who did not consent to be a part of the study with severe systemic comorbidities and who were already on treatment for dry eye disease. It was a multi-design study which was cross-sectional at baseline, and we subsequently followed up the patients who received CPAP therapy. We recruited 150 consecutive subjects, and 62 of these patients received CPAP therapy and were followed up with us
after 3 months, and 150 age and gender matched controls were also included. Dry eye disease was defined as per the DEWS dry eye grading system. Coming to the result, the baseline tear film breakup time and Schirmer values was significantly lower in the OSA group as compared to the controls, and we found that 24% of the OSA patients had dry eye disease as compared to 16% of the controls, and 41% of the patients had MGD as compared to 23% of the controls, with the occurrence of MGD being significantly higher. And after adjusting for age, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, smoking, alcohol, CAD, and ocular surgery, we found that OSA patients were 3.11 times as likely to have MGD as compared to controls, which was significantly higher. We also evaluated them for ocular symptoms based on our study pro forma, and we found that more than half the OSA patients had at least one ocular symptom, which was significantly higher than the controls. And of the 300 eyes of the 150 OSA patients, 19 eyes took up fluorescein staining, with the inferior quadrant being the most commonly stained quadrant. We did a subgroup analysis as per the grade of obstructive sleep apnea, and we found that as the obstructive sleep apnea increased from mild to moderate to severe, the occurrence of dry eye disease, MGD, and symptoms all increased, and so was the likelihood for occurrence. Coming to the secondary objective, amongst the eyelid diseases, we found that the occurrence of floppy eyelid syndrome was significantly higher. As you can see in the picture here, there's a picture of a patient with grade 1 FES, there's one of grade 2 floppy eyelid syndrome, and another picture showing a lower lid snapback test positive. We also had a higher incidence of keratoconus or abnormal tomography. So here is a case of a patient with lady with severe OSA, and the pentacam shows an increased Kmax thinned out pachy, and posterior elevation increased to 19 in the left eye. Amongst the posterior segment diseases, there was also a higher occurrence of CSC and old vascular occlusions in the OSA group. And here is a swept source OCT showing a neurosensory detachment at the macula, suggestive of a central serous chorioretinopathy. So we also evaluated the effect of sleep therapy, that is CPAP therapy, on the ocular surface. 62 patients followed up after 3 months of therapy, and the findings were suggestive of worsening of ocular surface disease after the initial 3 months of CPAP therapy. So to conclude, I'd like to say a baseline ophthalmic screening should be done in OSA. Both the ophthalmologist and the pulmonary physician should be aware of the spectrum of the disease, and integrated multi-speciality care must be provided to these patients. Further prospective studies are needed to help better understand if OSA is a causative factor, because there are many confounders between OSA and ocular diseases. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Arjun.
Correlating it with functional vision loss in patients with primary open angle glaucoma. So as we all know, around 50% of the nerve tissue is lost when it is first evident on the visual fields, and earlier studies have shown a strong structure function correlation, and the structural changes precede the functional changes. Hence, early detection of RNFL thinning becomes an important marker in detecting early glaucoma. Unlike the 2D scans, the 3D OCT scans are faster, and they have high density volume scans, thereby missing lesser areas. There has been only one study in the past that has evaluated a novel 3D parameter in detecting early glaucoma. Hence, the aim of our study was to see if there's any structure function correlation in patients with POAG, and also to look into the sensitivity of novel 3D parameters, kappa, mu, and sigma, in detecting early glaucoma. Just to re-emphasize, by 3D OCT parameters, I mean that the standard SSOCT or SSOCT can be used, and the data extrapolated is more than what is reported by the standard software. Ours was a cross-sectional comparative study which was accepted by the institutional board, and the sample size was 132 eyes distributed among normal glaucoma suspects and POAG patients, and the study duration was for 10 months. These were the inclusion criteria and these were the exclusion criteria. Coming to the methodology, our subjects, as I said, were normal eyes were 24 eyes, glaucoma suspects 18 eyes, and POAG were 19 eyes. So the normal patients were the ones who had no family history of glaucoma, IOP less than 21, and non-glaucomatous optic discs. Glaucoma suspects had either of the following features, that is suspicious looking optic disc or RNFL, visual field suspicious of glaucomatous damage, or patients with consistently elevated IOP with normal appearance of optic disc, RNFL, or visual fields. The POAG patients were the ones who had optic nerve head changes correlating with the visual fields, corrected IOP less than 21, and open angles on gonioscopy. These patients were further classified based on mean deviation into early, moderate, and advanced glaucoma. The appropriate statistical tests were used in our analysis. And then how were the GEV parameters derived? So the RNFL thickness values that we obtained from the 3D scans range from 0 to 200. And hence it was necessary to model both the extremes of the intensity with a suitable mathematic function. Hence we used the generalized extreme value distribution to fit the RNFL thicknesses in the subjects. this was derived from the maximum likelihood estimation method, and the parameters were kappa, which indicated the shape of the distribution, mu, which was the location of the peak, and sigma, the scale of the graph. Let's look into the results. This was the mean age of all the patients studied. We saw a male preponderance, and we saw most of the patients were hypertensives, except in the early glaucoma group, they were diabetics. So this is the table showing the correlation between RNFL thickness and pattern standard deviation. In the glaucoma suspects group, we saw a fair correlation, negative correlation for inferior RNFL thickness and temporal RNFL thickness. And in the moderate glaucoma group, we saw for the superior RNFL thickness, we saw a negative correlation. And in the advanced group, we saw average and inferior RNFL thickness. However, our p-value, what we used was a higher sensitivity of 0.001. And there was no significant correlation between RNFL thickness and the mean deviation that we did. Looking to the AUC analysis for the RNFL thickness for normal versus glaucoma groups, the average RNFL thickness had higher area under the curve with a statistically significant p-value, followed by inferior and superior RNFL thickness. Also, the rim area saw higher area under the curve, which was statistically significant. Therefore, among the OCT parameters, the best diagnostic accuracy was for RNFL thickness and rim area. Looking into the GEV parameters for normal glaucoma suspects and early glaucoma group only, because this can be picked up by the 2D OCT parameters as well, the median value for normal for K, mu and sigma was higher when compared to the glaucoma suspects and early glaucoma. And when we compared the p-value for normal and versus glaucoma groups, the kappa, mu and sigma was statistically significant. And for glaucoma suspects versus early glaucoma group, only the mu and sigma values were statistically significant. Coming to the AUC analysis for the GEV parameters, in all the comparisons that we did, mu and sigma was found to be having the highest area under the curve. So the GEV parameters mu and sigma have better sensitivity in detecting early glaucoma. To summarize, we did not find any strong structure function correlation in our study, probably because of the lesser sample size, and we didn't do a sectoral comparison between the visual fields and the OCT analysis. But among the OCT parameters, average RNFL thickness and rim area had better diagnostic accuracy, and among the 3D parameters studied, mu and sigma could distinguish glaucoma suspects and from the early glaucoma group and normalize. To conclude, by utilizing more information from the existing test and tools, we can detect early glaucoma, and a longitudinal study is required to build up the database and develop a model which can predict early glaucoma. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Aswini. Panelist, please. In the meantime, I would like...
Good afternoon, everyone, respected faculty, and my dear friends. Today, I will be presenting on my thesis, Predictors for Surgical Outcomes in Stage 4A Retinopathy of Prematurity. The study was done at RPC Ames. So as we all know, stage 4A is defined as partial retinal detachment not involving macula, and few studies have been documented in the literature which shows there are favorable surgical outcomes in stage 4A of ROP. But lacuna is that literature does not distinguish between varied stage 4A ROP presentations. As we can see in this picture, these are all having different amount of traction, which in this is the most severe traction, but they are all labeled as stage 4A as the macula was attached. So there is a need to study the entire surgical outcomes across the entire surgical spectrum of stage 4A ROP. Also, many cases are referred late as opposed to west in our country because of late screening, referral and treatment. So the causes of late presentation needs to be ascertained. So with these objectives, we tried to do the study, and it was a single arm prospective interventional study, and we assessed all the stage 4A ROP babies who met our inclusion criteria. And the follow-up period after surgery was 12 weeks follow-up. All the babies who met our inclusion criteria underwent 25-gauge lens-sparing pars plana vitrectomy with traction release under general anesthesia. And at the end of 12 weeks follow-up, we were able to analyze 61 eyes of 43 babies. So as far as pre-op parameters, most of the babies in our study had zone 2 ROP, and surprisingly, majority of the eyes, more than 50%, had plus disease at the onset. And regarding preoperative treatment received, approximately 9 of the 61 eyes, that is 16% eyes, did not receive any prior treatment. So this was something shocking, as it could amount to gross medical negligence on the part of the primary ophthalmologist. So we tried to do 25 gauge pars plana lensectomy, pars plana vitrectomy, and approximately majority of the surgeries were unilateral surgeries and 42% were bilateral surgeries. And after initial surgery, we tried to obtain good operative, post-operative outcomes, but there were 19 eyes which required second and third surgery also. So 19 out of 61 eyes, that means around one third of the eyes needed second surgery. And most common post-operative complication for which the second surgery was done was dispersed vitreous bleed, persistent traction. So at the end of 12 weeks, 3 months follow-up, we classified as functional outcome and structural outcome. So as far as structural outcome, the favorable outcome was defined as the retina remains attached, disc macula remains attached, and the traction gets released. So in around 40%, the 40 eyes, the ROP regressed. In 15 eyes, there was ROP sequelae. That means the traction was relieved, but there was disc or macular drag. And in 6 eyes, 10% of the eyes, the ROP progressed to advanced stage 5 ROP. So in conclusion, 90%, we were able to obtain 90% favorable outcome, and all eyes fixed and follow light. So we tried to analyze various predictors for post-operative posterior pole attachment, classifying into preoperative systemic and ocular predictors, and we found that gestational age more than 28 weeks have a good preoperative outcome as compared to those who are born less than 28 weeks. Also, the hemoglobin level, if it is more than 10 gram per deciliter, then it showed good postoperative outcome as compared to less than 10. And regarding preoperative ocular predictors, we found interestingly TRD extent, if it is less than 7 clock hours, there were 97.2% chances of getting a good outcome. Also, intraoperatively, need for lensectomy, in 2 cases it was needed due to retrolental high TRD, and it caused poor outcome in those babies. Postoperatively, all the babies that needed resurgery had poor outcome. But interestingly, 71.4% of babies who we operated second time, we were able to save those eyes. So timely resurgery is one of the key message of this presentation. So representatively, postoperatively, pre-op, there is extensive traction, and post-op after surgery, the traction got relieved with early intervention. So we also analyzed various reasons for advanced ROP and found that late screening was one of the major reasons for the late presentation of ROP, followed by late referral or no treatment. The reasons primary were, as the babies are sick, so prolonged NICU care. And because of prolonged NICU care, the child was systemically unstable, and that's why there was delay in screening. So conclusion is, the predictors for good outcome in my surgery were bigger babies who have gestational age more than 28 weeks, preoperative hemoglobin more than 10 gram per deciliter, and TRD extent less than 7 clock hours. And predictor for poor outcome, persistent plus disease, inferior TRD, and any need for lensectomy or postoperative vitreous bleed. Thank you.
All the competitors must adhere to the time, because there is 10 marks for that. And now, Dr. Naresh Babu or Dr.
Intrastromal injections of voriconazole, amphotericin B, and natamycin in case of fungal keratitis. We know microbial keratitis is one of the leading causes of blindness in the world, and it is causing visual disabilities in Middle East, Asia, and African countries. And fungal keratitis contributes to 34.4% cases of corneal ulcers in South India. The main modes of administration of antifungal drugs include topical, intracameral, systemic, and intrastromal. Intrastromal drugs have recently gained a lot of reviews because of their efficacy, which has been proven in various studies. Natamycin, we know, is a standard care, and Natazole was actually, it's not 5% Natamycin which we are injecting. Instead, Natazole is a novel preparation which was prepared in the ocular pharmacology department of our institute using the Natamycin powder and cyclodextrin mixed in water. The concentration was decided to be 10 microgram per 0.1 ml according to the animal studies, which proved it to be efficacious for both Aspergillus and Fusarium. This was patented. So those studies have compared this novel drug with intrastromal voriconazole and amphotericin B, which have been previously used. So our aim was to do that. Outcome was best corrected visual acuity, and secondary outcomes were healing of epithelial defect and resolution of infiltrates. It was a prospective interventional study, and it was done in 60 eyes of 60 patients who presented to the cornea clinic. Ethics committee approval was obtained, and the study has also been registered in CTRI. We included all the patients who presented with more than 2 mm non-perforated recalcitrant ulcers. By recalcitrant, we meant that there was no change in the size of epithelial defect, increase in the size of the hypopyon, or decrease of less than 20% of stromal infiltrate. At least 2 weeks after starting treatment, the three groups were randomized, and the patients received treatment according to the random number table. The injections were given under strict aseptic precautions, and repeat intrastromal injections were given if the patients didn't respond within 72 hours, and maximum of 3 injections were given. Post-op evaluation was done. An investigator who was following up was masked. Statistical analysis was done, and I present my results now. The baseline characters were matched. Fungal culture was positive in 70% cases of voriconazole, 65% of amphotericin B, and 55% in natamycin. There was no significant difference between Aspergillus and Fusarium, although Aspergillus was most commonly present and then followed by Fusarium. Visual acuity improved from day 0 to 6 months. However, no significant difference was present between the three groups in terms of visual acuity. The various parameters which affect visual acuity, like the posterior segment findings, which were anechoic in all cases, cataract was not significant. There was no significant difference in the three groups on the basis of cataracts, and the location of ulcers, also there was no significant difference. Again, the mean size of epithelial defect reduced from day 0 to 6 months, and the duration of healing, if you look, the faster resolution was seen in natamycin group. Similarly, stromal infiltrate size also reduced with faster healing seen in natamycin group. Hypopyon reduction was also seen to be faster in natamycin group. There was no significant difference present in three groups in terms of repeat intrastromal injections. 95% eyes healed in voriconazole group, 90% eyes healed in amphotericin B group, and 95% eyes healed in natamycin group. There was no significant difference in the mean scar size. However, deep vascularization of scar was more often seen in amphotericin B group, and the difference was statistically significant between the three groups. So these are various pre-op, pre-injections and post-injection pictures at various point of times which were taken. Coming to our discussion, so our results were comparable. The visual acuity results were comparable to the previous results. Similarly, the number of patients healed were also comparable. The mean duration of healing was also comparable. And finally, the MUT1, if we look at the MUT1 trial, our study collaborates with the results of MUT1 trial, which stated that natamycin is better than voriconazole. Thus, to conclude, intrastromal injections of natamycin, voriconazole, and amphotericin B were effective in resolution of keratitis. And vascularization of greater depth was seen in corneal scars in where amphotericin B was used. Natamycin caused earlier healing of epithelial defect and stromal infiltrate as compared to the other groups. Our recommendations are that intrastromal injections are safe and effective as an adjunct for the treatment, and a study for effectiveness of intrastromal natamycin is needed in a larger sample size. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Reddy, please. And Dr. Madhuri is there. Please get ready.
Okay. But you are shown all your three drugs are equal, but MUT study has shown that voriconazole is inferior.
Yes, so actually I had shown that the faster duration of resolution of infiltrates, the faster healing of epithelial defect was more with the intrastromal natamycin group. That was my result. I have not shown the three groups to be equal.
So this is natamycin is your proprietary, no? This is not a regular available natamycin.
No, that has been prepared in our ocular pharmacology department.
This is a separate one because natamycin cannot inject
yes,
regular.
We cannot, that is another
thing. This is a property your own.
Yes, yes.
But you are not, it's not, you are saying that on the presentation that it is online with the MUT, but it's not online with the MUT. Your voriconazole results are better than with the MUT study. MUT study, voriconazole, they had more perforations, bad results when compared with natamycin.
In our study, intrastromal natamycin, so actually our study has been conducted in North India. MUT has been conducted in South India. And their explanation was that because in South India, fusarium is more common, hence natamycin is more effective in fusarium because of the MIC values. Now we are injecting the drug directly into the stroma. So that difference has now been negated.
In your original in your original thesis, which didn't come out here, you made a mistake in the amphotericin concentration that you've mentioned. The method of
surgery is complex and poor, has been attributed to excessive or abnormal wound healing, which results in scarring. The presence of foreign body in the form of sutures and silicon tube, along with aqueous flow and surgical trauma, complicate the process. The objective of this study was to understand the effects of aqueous flow on the healing process by measuring the levels of commonly expressed cytokines at various time points. This was a prospective experimental study done on 92 adult Sprague-Dawley rat eyes. The first group, or the baseline group, represented the effects of surgical trauma. A superior conjunctival incision was given, followed by closure. The control group represented the combined effects of trauma and foreign body, where a subconjunctival silicon tube foreign body was placed. The experimental group represented the combined effects of surgical trauma, foreign body, and aqueous flow. So we devised this model of filtering surgery. Rats were weighed, and anesthesia was induced intraperitoneally. An 80 vitrile suture was applied on the upper eyelid to prolapse the globe and expose the surgical site. A limbal-based conjunctival flap was made. Using a 10-0 nylon suture, a 3mm silicon tube was secured to the sclera. A 26-gauge needle was used to make an AC entry. The aqueous flow was visualized, and the bevel end of the tube was placed in the anterior chamber to maintain a patent fistula for the aqueous flow. The wound was closed, and at the end of the surgery, a filtering bleb was appreciated. Tissue from the surgical site was harvested at 7 pre-decided time points from day 1 to 3 week post-surgery, followed by enucleating the eyeball, and the cytokines were analyzed in 3 panels. Coming to the pro-fibrotic panel, TGF-beta, this is a graph representing the mean expression level of TGF-beta at various time points. There was a sustained and an elevated expression noted in the aqueous group, which is the blue line, till day 7. The other two groups showed a rapid decline by day 2, indicating that the presence of aqueous in the tissue led to more scarring, inflammation, and fibrosis. In the pro-inflammatory panel, the presence of aqueous in the tissue shifted the timeline of IL-13 expression by 1 or 2 days to the right, indicating a delayed remodeling and increased duration of proliferation. There was also a spike noted at day 2, depicting the macrophage-rich inflammation. The other 4 cytokines, IL-1 alpha, TNF alpha, and IL-6, were elevated to begin with. However, at subsequent time points, there was no significant difference noted. In the anti-inflammatory panel, interferon gamma is a cytokine which inhibits the activity of human fibroblasts. In the presence of aqueous, which is the blue line, there was a delayed peak at day 14, whereas in the other two groups, there was a peak at day 5, indicating that the flow of aqueous leads to suppression and a delay in expression of interferon gamma, thereby prolonging the proliferative phase and delaying remodeling. Interleukin-10 is another cytokine which inhibits the activity of the activated macrophages to produce the pro-inflammatory ones. Here we can appreciate a peak in the control and the baseline groups at day 5, which helped in the transition of the healing process to the next phase. Whereas in the presence of aqueous, there was a downgradation of expression of this cytokine, promoting a continued state of inflammation and a delay in the wound healing. Normal wound healing after surgical trauma passes through 4 phases, which has been studied extensively in animal models. Aqueous humor affects this healing process by bringing in a new chemical environment in contact with the conjunctival tissue, along with its mechanical and possible metabolic effects on the tissue. In rat eyes, in the presence of aqueous, this process is significantly prolonged with a much higher inflammatory load to begin with, leading to more fibrosis and a delayed onset of remodeling. To conclude, flow of aqueous alters the healing process as seen by the cytokines expression, both quantitatively as well as qualitatively, which is distinct from the normal wound healing and healing compounded by foreign body. A better understanding of this procedure can help in development of targeted molecules and appropriately time the application of antimetabolites, thereby prolonging the bleb survival and improving the success rate of GFS, which is the most commonly performed surgery when intraocular pressure is failed to be controlled by anti-glaucoma medications. Thank you.
Thank you.
One question from any of the
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Ram. I'll be presenting my thesis, which is a study on correlation between pituitary adenoma tumor size volume and the retinal nerve fibrillary thickness, ganglion cell complex thickness, and visual field sensitivity for better predicting visual prognosis. So as we know, the pituitary gland lies in close proximity to the optic chiasm, and most of the patients present with a bitemporal hemianopic field effect. One of the most common questions asked by the neurologist and the patients would be the visual recovery post-surgery. So keeping this question in mind, we planned our study to analyze visual parameters like visual acuity, visual field, OCT parameters in patients with pituitary adenoma. The patients were recruited from the neuro-ophthalmology department, and the period of study lasted for 18 months. We had 36 patients, 18 in the intervention group and 18 in the control group. It was a prospective comparative study. It was approved by the ethics committee. Patients with pituitary tumors with chiasmal compression confirmed on neuroimaging were included in the study. Any anterior segment, posterior segment, or optic nerve disease other than compressive optic neuropathy were excluded from the study. Basic details of the patients were collected and MRI reports were collected, following which Cavalier's principle was used to calculate the tumor volume, after which the patients were subjected to visual field testing in the OCT scans. The total number of visits were 3 preoperatively, immediate postoperative period, and the postoperative 3 months period. Control group patients were collected from the general ophthalmology clinic and were matched with age. Appropriate statistical analysis was done. Coming to the results, the mean age in the intervention group was 42 years and the mean age in the control group was 35 years. We found a male preponderance in our study in contrast to the literature. This is the MRI-based tumor volume distribution. It ranged from less than 1 cubic mm to more than 30 cubic mm. So the mean deviation showed consistent improvement postoperatively when compared to the pre-op values in both the eyes. Similarly, the pattern standard deviation also showed improvement postoperatively from their pre-op values, but there was less improvement in the left eye. The RNFL overall average thickness did not show any improvement postoperatively. The GCC overall average thickness showed marginal improvement in postoperatively. Now, what was most striking was the GCC focal loss volume, which showed improvement in though less in the left eye, but it was correlating with the visual fields. We found a strong positive correlation with the RNFL infranasal quadrant thickness and the postoperative 3 months value, and a strong negative correlation between the GCC FLV and the postoperative 3 months. In order to explain the prognosis, we used linear regression, and by substituting a certain pre-op parameter, like in this example, GCC pre-op FLV value, we were able to predict the postoperative 3 months mean deviation. In the left eye, we found the strong positive correlation between the nasal lower quadrant RNFL thickness and the postoperative 3 months. Similarly, linear regression was done. What was more interesting was by using multiple regression analysis, the restoration of the visual field can be predicted by using MRI grade inversion, preoperative mean deviation, and the GCC preoperative focal loss volume. Thus, we can predict visual recovery. The BCVA and the tumor volume were not relatable in our study. We found the PSD to be more sensitive indicator of the visual field effect. Danish et al. Concluded that patients with thin RNFL preoperatively did not improve post-surgery. The quadrant-wise analysis, our study found what was already published in the literature, that the temporal and nasal quadrants were involved. Out of all the GCC parameters, focal loss volume was the most useful indicator. So to conclude, patients with high structural deterioration had worse visual outcome. Nasal RNFL is the best prognostic factor in our subjects. FLV is the best parameter to predict visual function following surgical decompression. Regression equations can also be used for better predicting visual prognosis. Thank you.
Any of the judges?
Glaucoma and its correlation with histopathology of trabecular meshwork.
We all know that primary congenital glaucoma is a type of childhood glaucoma that is associated with abnormal development of trabecular meshwork, and surgical treatment remains the mainstay of its management. We believe that better understanding of its histopathology may allow for a better targeted therapy in the future. However, the present literature is quite limited in this regards. So we conducted a prospective interventional study to evaluate the long-term prognosis of PCG and to correlate it with histopathology of trabecular meshwork. We included all the consecutive children presenting over a period of 1 year to our center with age less than 1 year a diagnosis of PCG and less than 2 years when operated. We included only naive PCG eyes who were not subjected to any ocular surgeries before, and all the eyes with coexistent ocular systemic pathologies, and children whose samples did not show evidence of trabecular meshwork and histopathology were excluded. So after obtaining a detailed history and performing a detailed general and ophthalmic examination, all the children were given a trial of medical management, and following which primary combined trabeculotomy to trabeculectomy augmented with mitomycin C 0.04% was undertaken. All the children were followed up for 1 year after surgery, and surgical success was defined as IOP less than 14 mm mercury at all follow-ups. The surgical specimens obtained during surgery were sent for histopathological examination. We limited our study only to the light microscopy, which was examined by one experienced ocular pathology and one experienced ocular glaucoma surgeon. So histopathological qualitative and quantitative findings included looking for presence of eosinophilic membrane, trabecular bearing arrangement, and endothelial cell morphology, availability of intervening spaces. Based on all these findings, our specimens were divided into low, moderate, and high cellular arbitrarily. So coming to the results now, we had more number of females in a study, and this was explained by variable inclusion criteria. 85% of cases had bilateral involvement, and 85% of them needed surgical management for control of IOP. IOP decreased dramatically from 29 to 13 mm mercury after surgery, with the maximum change occurring within first 1 month. Corneal diameters only changed insignificantly after surgery, with however the number of corneas that were actually hazy cleared up almost double after surgery. The Cupp-Disc ratio showed a significant tendency for reversal after surgery, and maximum changes occurred within the first 6 months. Surprisingly, we saw that our blebs had a significant tendency to change from well-formed type to thin cystic type, a finding which has never been reported before in any study, and we attributed this to a surgeon control factor, as all the surgeries were undertaken by a single surgeon. So coming to the histopathological results, eosinophilic membrane was appreciated in 35%, fused trabecular beams either partial or total were seen in 55%, and intervening spaces were seen in 60%. Pleomorphism of endothelial cells was appreciated in 25% cases, with maximum pleomorphism occurring in high cellular specimen. Although low cellular specimens are the most common in our study, we found that high cellular specimens were thicker significantly when compared to other specimens. So when we saw the fused trabecular beams, we found that they were associated with higher axial length and higher baseline IOP, while eosinophilic membrane was negatively correlated with the baseline IOP, and low cellular TM was associated with higher baseline axial length. Baseline IOP of less than 20 mm mercury was present only in 17% cases, and it correlated positively with trabecular meshwork thickness, indicating that thinner specimens had lower baseline IOP. So coming to the surgical success, we saw that whenever high cellular specimens were absent, the incidence of surgical success, surgical failure was 0%. However, surprisingly, this did not correlate with quantitative endothelial cell density, where lower endothelial cells was expected to have a higher baseline IOP. So based on our findings, we can suggest that thick subcanalicular tissue in immature trabecular meshwork was responsible for severe early form of PCG in Indian eyes. According to Hollander et al., our eyes fall into severe goniodysgenesis. However, further subclassification was difficult due to simultaneous presence and interaction of different histopathological changes, and various subgroup analysis did not allow us to have a significant p-value for classification into further subdivisions. Although eyes with more clear intervening spaces were expected to have lower IOP, no such thing was seen in our study, and this could be because the fused beams on the cameral side prevented passage of aqueous through these spaces. Lesser division of cells was more desirable than aberrant division, because latter culminated in thicker and pleomorphic trabecular meshwork, which was inefficient in controlling IOP both at baseline and after surgery. Major limitation of our study was that there were no controls, and association post-surgery were actually unreliable with the histopathological features. So we recommend larger studies to validate our results. From our study, despite its limitations, we can conclude that performing a light microscopic analysis of surgical specimens may guide prognosis of PCG, and further studies may actually help in designing targeted therapies aiming for an increase in trabecular spaces towards cameral site, and decreasing aberrant regeneration of trabecular endothelial cells may improve its medical management. However, presently, we have to remember that maintaining a controlled IOP is more important than any other feature for control of the disease process in itself. Thank you. These are my references.
Dr. Rinki, just to go, but we have to keep the time reserved for them. They may be last minute entry.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dr. Shimpa, and my thesis topic was the study of ocular blood flow in primary open-angle glaucoma and normal tension glaucoma. Glaucoma is suspected to be a multifactorial disease with IOP-dependent and independent risk factors like decreased ocular blood flow, oxidative stress, decreased exoplasmic flow, and genetic background. A number of studies have generated strong evidence that decreased ocular blood flow may be a risk factor in the pathogenesis and progression of glaucoma. Under normal condition, the relationship between the blood flow and perfusion pressure in the eye is autoregulated. Autoregulation is the capacity to maintain relatively constant level of blood flow in the presence of changes in ocular perfusion pressure and various metabolic demands. Ocular perfusion pressure plays a key role in the progression of diseases such as glaucoma and diabetic retinopathy. Aim of our study was to study ocular blood flow in POAG and NTG by color Doppler imaging to compare the end-diastolic peak systolic velocity resistive index in central retinal posterior ciliary and ophthalmic artery with age match controls to establish any relation between ocular blood flow and structural and functional damage in glaucoma. Our study was carried out in the outpatient department of a tertiary eye hospital. It was a prospective cross-sectional study. 30 cases of NTG and POAG along with 30 controls were taken. Institution scientific and ethical guidelines were adhered and informed consent was taken from all the patients. Ocular blood flow was measured in this way. Color Doppler imaging was done for all the patients in the supine position with the eyes closed by a single observer. Sterile coupling gel was applied to the eyelids and using a 9 megahertz probe, the examination was carried out with the avoidance of undue manual pressure on the probe. B-scan imaging was done and then color Doppler was started and grayscale imaging in which the orbital anatomy were overviewed and the individual vessels were visualized using Doppler frequency shift from the specific sample volume. This sample volume is placed over the vessel of interest and the frequency shifts are seen. In the central retinal artery, it is along with the central retinal central vein and therefore there a double waveform was seen. In the short posterior ciliary artery, there were numerous short posterior ciliary artery, both temporal and nasal to the optic nerve. So this was unreliable. Ophthalmic artery was a reliable artery because it was very easy to find and it was temporal to the optic nerve. The velocities present in the sample volume follow the cardiac cycle, allowing measurement to be taken at the peak of systole, that was peak systolic velocity, and the lowest point of diastole, that is end diastolic velocity. Restive index was calculated by subtracting end diastolic velocity from peak systolic velocity, dividing it by peak systolic velocity. It was a parameter ranging from 0 to 1. Normal was less than 0.7, more than 0.85 was considered higher, and it implies increased peripheral resistance causing direct impedance to ocular blood flow. Carotid artery was analyzed to rule out any stenosis and plaques. Inclusion criteria of our study were the newly diagnosed cases which were not on anti-glaucoma medications. Exclusion were with the secondary open angle glaucoma and angle closure glaucoma. Other with the ocular blood flow where diseases with ocular blood flow was compromised like diabetic retinopathy, CRVO, BRVO, arterial occlusion, post-trap patient, history of any retinal surgery, penetrating keratoplasties, patient on systemic beta blockers. Mean IOP was highest in the POAG group. RNFL thickness was comparable in the POAG and NTG. Severe field effects were seen in the POAG group. Restive index was found to be highest in the central retinal artery of the NTG group, showing it was 0.9. In 73.3% of the cases of central retinal artery of NTG show restive index 1, which implies significant stenosis of the vessel limit. Why restive index of ophthalmic artery significant? Because the results are reliable and reproducible, and it represents the main blood supply to the ocular structure. Restive index in the NTG group were compared for the visual field effect, and there was 66% increase in the restive index in the early visual field effect group, and 83.3% increase restive index, that is more than 0.85 in the moderate visual field effect group. In POG, no such relationship was established. For the RNFL thickness, there was a negative correlation in the NTG, while in POG, no such significant relationship was established. Due to loss of neural tissue, there is a reduced metabolic demand, so few capillaries are required to nourish retinal ganglion cells, which lead to reduced blood flow to retinal ganglion cells. Reduction in retrobulbar and retinal blood flow over time were associated with structural glaucomatous progression, which was seen in Tobey et al. No such relationship was established in the POAG for the RNFL thickness. Other parameters studied were systolic blood pressure, diastolic blood pressure, mean ocular perfusion pressure, and mean ocular perfusion pressure fluctuation. There was a positive correlation between systolic blood pressure and resistive index in NTG. That is, there is a decrease in blood flow as systolic blood pressure increases because there is an increased perfusion of the ciliary body resulting in increased aqueous production and a higher IOP leading to decreased perfusion to the optic disc from sclerotic arterioles. For diastolic blood pressure, there was a negative correlation, that is decrease in ocular blood flow when diastolic pressure decreases in both NTG and POAG. Low diastolic pressure has been documented to a risk factor in open angle glaucoma. In conclusion, vascular factors are actively involved in the pathogenesis of NTG and POG. Role of ocular blood flow is more significant in NTG. Measuring ocular blood flow can play a role in early detection of glaucoma, as vascular disturbances are found in cases with early defects, and the weak relation between the structural loss and functional damage due to decrease in ocular blood flow appears to be neither a major consequent nor a strong cause of neural tissue loss. Thank you.
Please understand that all your theses have been sent to us in advance. So we have gone through 40 pages in some cases, and we already know what you are presenting. So you don't have to repeat 40 pages in 5 minutes. Just give the salient features and the conclusions. Give more attention to the salient features, the conclusions. Don't crowd your slides and don't rush through. Even if you speak less in the discussion, you can say that this was mentioned in the thesis, because all the judges have been sent the thesis. Yeah?
So.